thorium reactors are like the solid-state batteries of nuclear power, vastly superior, yet forever on the horizon. But now, a Danish company is closer than ever to turning them into a reality. Its reactors are designed to deliver on thorium's decades-old promise, a self-sustaining chain reaction that breeds fresh fuel, making energy cheaper and more abundant than ever. These aren't just thorium reactors. They're small modular reactors designed to function as shipping container-sized self-maintaining batteries that operate reliably for years. So how is this company tackling such an ambitious engineering challenge? When might commercial thorium reactors finally arrive? And is thorium the missing piece of the clean energy puzzle? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark. In the 1950s and 60s, the Atomic Energy Commission sought to transform nuclear energy from a source of fear into a source of energy too cheap to meter. Under director Alvin Weinberg, scientists at the Oak Ridge National Laboratory in Tennessee developed a radically different type of reactor and fuel cycle, one that promised to breed more fuel than it burned, potentially powering civilization for thousands of years. Their design, a molten salt reactor running on fuel bred from thorium, ran successfully for 15,000 hours from 1965 to 1969, producing a steady 8 megawatts of heat. So why don't we have this limitless thorium energy today? Because the project was defunded after the Atomic Energy Commission shifted its research focus to a different kind of breeder reactor, which too was plagued by technical challenges until its own cancellation. As for Weinberg, he was fired for continuing to champion thorium. He wrote wistfully in his memoir, "I hope that in a second nuclear era, the molten salt technology will be resurrected." Weinberg's wish might just come true thanks to a Danish company. No, not that kind with icing and almonds, although that's a pretty sweet solution for a different kind of energy slump. Copenhagen Atomics is a startup out of Denmark reviving Weinberg's hopes for a so-called breeder reactor, one that creates more fissile fuel than it burns. And they're one of the handful of companies answering the call for cheaper nuclear power with small modular reactors. And when I say small, I mean Copenhagen Atomics reactor is designed to fit inside of a standard 40-foot shipping-sized container. And by modular, I mean they aim to mass produce one reactor per day on an assembly line, then truck as many as needed to a plant site to hit the desired power output. Shrinking nuclear reactors like this could make them cheaper to build and easier to scale with rising energy demand. And because they're building the same design over and over, they can work out the kinks in the manufacturing process, which means delivering reactors at a predictable cost instead of the massive overruns that have plagued large, custom-built nuclear power plants. I'm going to let CEO and co-founder Thomas Jan Petersen explain how they're fitting nuclear reactors into a box. But first, a refresher on nuclear chain reactions. You probably know uranium as the go-to fuel in conventional reactors. When struck by a neutron, uranium-235 splits, releasing a huge amount of energy and a few neutrons that go on to split more uranium-235. If there's enough fuel and moderator like water to slow these neutrons down, the chain reaction sustains itself, producing heat to make steam, then that steam spins a turbine to generate electricity. The Nuclear Energy Agency estimated that worldwide uranium reserves will only power us for another 200 years at current consumption rates. More recent estimates emphasize the importance of new exploration and processing techniques that will be necessary to expand its usage into the future. As I shared in a recent episode of the revival of old nuclear power plants to power data centers, nuclear energy is set to expand worldwide as we reach for low-emission solutions to today's booming energy demands. However, there's a solution to uranium scarcity, and that's another element, thorium. It's not only 3 to 4 times more common in Earth's crust, because only 0.7% of natural uranium is the chain reaction-forming 235 variety, thorium is actually nearly 500 times more abundant than the uranium that we rely on for nuclear energy today. Now, thorium can't form chain reactions like uranium-235, but if thorium is seeded with a little uranium-235 or plutonium-239, which are both fissile materials that release neutrons when they split, then thorium-232 can absorb a neutron and become thorium-233. Which beta decays into protactanium-233 and then into uranium-233. And this is the clever bit. Because uranium-233 is fissile, it splits and releases neutrons that sustain a chain reaction. Whereas chain reacting uranium-235 in an old school reactor just eats up more fuel, the neutrons split out from the uranium-233 create more fuel from thorium. But how?
And those 2.35 neutrons gives you a little bit more, because you need one of those neutrons to split the next uranium atom in the chain reaction. and you need another atom or another neutron to upgrade your thorium to uranium, but then you have this 0.35 extra. So you can generate a little bit more fuel than you consume all the time.
So instead of burning up an ever-dwindling supply of nuclear fuel, or even burning up as much fuel as it makes, the thorium fuel cycle lets us breed more nuclear fuel than it consumes. Once optimized, each reactor could generate enough fuel to start another every 10 to 20 years. And those new reactors could do the same. That means doubling nuclear capacity every few decades without burning through the world's uranium reserves.
If you really want to have 10 or 20 or 100 times more energy on this planet, then we need what is called breeder reactors.
This is the thorium dream and Copenhagen Atomics' ultimate goal, to build a breeder reactor. But to encourage a fundamentally different reaction, they need a fundamentally different reactor, the molten salt reactor, or MSR. This is where things get more interesting and safer. Molten salt reactors using thorium aren't just efficient, they're designed to avoid meltdowns altogether. And speaking of keeping things safe, let's take a quick moment to talk about protecting your digital life too. I was just on a trip to a geothermal conference, and between the conference Wi-Fi hotspots and hotel Wi-Fi, I leaned heavily on Surfshark VPN to keep my connection secure and private. I've been using Surfshark for what feels like forever and get so much use out of it. Surfshark is a fast, easy-to-use VPN full of incredible features that you can install on an unlimited number of devices with one account. But that's not all. Even shopping services will sometimes gate prices based on your location, so you can change your location to make sure you're getting the best deal. They also have add-ons to their VPN service to unlock things like Surfshark Alert, which will let you know if your email or personal details, like passwords, have been leaked in online data breaches. Right now, they're running a special deal. Go to surfshark.com/undecided or use the code undecided at checkout to get 4 extra months of Surfshark VPN. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. I've been using Surfshark for years, and I love it. Don't miss out on this great deal. The link's in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. All right, back to the molten salt magic. Unlike traditional reactors powered by solid fuel rods, MSRs are powered by uranium and thorium dissolved into molten salts. Because the fuel is liquid, waste products from nuclear fission can be extracted with the reactor still running. This continuous cleanup keeps the thorium to uranium reaction humming along by preserving neutrons for fuel production instead of letting them get soaked up by the waste. Liquid fuel salt acts as a coolant too, circling out and back into the reactor core to deliver heat for the power generation. In Copenhagen Atomics' layered onion core MSR, these hot salts are flanked by heavy water that slows down the neutrons so they can be better absorbed by thorium in the salt. And the outer layer of the onion will be a breeding blanket, where additional thorium salts will absorb neutrons produced by the chain reaction within the reactor core, breeding uranium-233. In the final design, this uranium will be transferred from the blanket to the molten salt fuel in the core.
When you have liquids, you can actually separate these things out. And it's a mix of chemistry and electrochemistry to do that, but it's a completely autonomous system that runs inside the reactor while the reactor is operating.
Another massive advantage of MSRs is that, unlike traditional water-cooled reactors that operate under high pressure to keep the water from boiling, molten salt reactors run at atmospheric pressure. That means no risk of high-pressure steam explosions and sudden loss of coolant or rapid overheating if a breach occurs. The molten salt simply cools and solidifies, trapping radioactive material and minimizing contamination. Many designs, like Copenhagen Atomics, even include frozen plugs at the bottom of the reactor vessel. If the system overheats, the plug melts, and the molten salt drains by gravity into a shielded dump tank, passively shutting down the reaction and preventing a meltdown.
And that's called walkaway safety. That means that if all the electricity is gone, if all the people run away, it's still safe. It's safe by itself because it has passive decay here. Heat removal.
But while thorium reactors are walk-away safe, they're not exactly walk-up safe. A small amount of uranium-232 forms during the production of uranium-233 and gives off intense gamma rays powerful enough to pass through centimeters of lead. That makes uranium-233, which could otherwise be an ideal bomb material, a logistical nightmare to steal or weaponize. However, it also means that Copenhagen Atomics will have to go to great lengths to keep that radiation contained. The plan is to avoid sending humans anywhere near the reactor containers. Each unit will be sealed in a steel box at about a half a meter or 20 inches thick that will weigh in at 1,000 tons, ship in 40-ton sections, and be welded together on site. Copenhagen Atomics will house 25 reactors in a single building. Remotely operated cranes and forklifts will handle the heavy lifting, keeping the process as hands-off as possible in order to cut down radiation exposure and red tape all in one go. While gamma radiation makes thorium reactors trickier to handle, nuclear waste from thorium reactors is actually much easier to manage. That's because fission products from traditional uranium-235 reactors includes plutonium and other elements that stay dangerously radioactive for tens of thousands of years. The waste from uranium-233 bred from thorium, on the other hand, decays much faster. It's kind of like choosing paper or plastic at the checkout lane, because instead of needing to store spent uranium fuel underground for tens of thousands of years, or even 100,000 years, thorium reactors' waste can often be safely stored above ground for just a few hundred years. And it gets even better. The bit of fissile material that's needed to start the thorium chain reaction can come from the waste of a traditional uranium reactor, allowing thorium systems to actually burn small amounts of legacy nuclear waste. Copenhagen Atomics plans to build this into their design, making their thorium reactor not just a fuel breeder, but a waste burner. So with all the advantages, how and when will Copenhagen Atomics commercialize the reactors? Well, thorium reactors demand much more than just new fuel. They also need pumps, pipes, and control systems that can survive a constant bath of corrosive salt as hot as lava. But it's not just the heat or corrosion, it's the neutron bombardment from the core that slowly wears down materials at an atomic level. And because the core also blasts out intense gamma radiation, these systems can't be serviced once the reactor is up and running. They have to work flawlessly for years, more like a sealed battery pack than a conventional machine. Here's how Copenhagen Atomics engineers are rising to the challenge. They've developed a molten salt pump that they say can run literally red hot, circulating a molten cocktail of fluoride, lithium, sodium, and potassium that's also known as FLINAC. I think that's how you say it, FLINAC? Now this salt mix exits the core at 700 degrees Celsius or 1300 degrees Fahrenheit and loops back in at around 600 degrees Celsius or 1100 degrees Fahrenheit. Now to avoid the wear and tear that dooms traditional pumps, this pump levitates its rotating parts on magnetic bearings, keeping the system humming for years. In preparation for going nuclear, the company is running molten FLINAC through dedicated test loops to shake out the problems and fine-tune the performance of the pump, the sensors, heat exchangers, and even the custom steel alloy that's used inside the reactor. The steel can endure corrosive salts and neutron bombardment for at least 5 years, after which the reactor module is shut down and swapped out for a fresh one. That's right, just 5 years. In traditional solid fuel reactors, corrosion and radiation mostly wear down the fuel rods and their cladding, which are components designed to be swapped out during routine refueling. But in molten salt reactors, the fuel is dissolved into the circulating salt, which flows through nearly every part of the system. That means the entire reactor module, core, pumps, and pipes, takes the hit. So instead of just replacing fuel rods, you eventually have to replace the whole unit. Ironically, the fuel and water moderator get saved.
And then the fuel salt and the heavy water, that can be reused. So the fuel salt and the heavy water is just the same, being used over and over and over again. And that's also the expensive part.
Even with frequent reactor swaps, Copenhagen Atomics still sees a path to low-cost power. And Peterson is quick to note the upside.
But the great thing about that is that every 5 years you are able to upgrade your technology. Whereas now with the classical nuclear reactors, they run for 50 or 60 years and it's still the old technology from back in whenever they were built. But in our case, we will keep on, you know, even after 50 years, it's still five-year-old technology. So that's sort of a plus in terms of keep on improving the efficiency of the system.
The company's next step is trucking a full-scale prototype reactor down to the Paul Scherrer Institute in Switzerland. That's the country's premier research campus for nuclear energy, with both a hot lab to handle radiation and an administration to handle the regulation. This public-private experiment will mark the first time a nuclear chain reaction kicks off inside of one of Copenhagen Atomics reactors, and the first time a thorium reactor is tested in Europe. The reactor will be powered by enriched uranium in the core and contain thorium in the surrounding breeding blanket. The test is slated for 2026 and will run for up to 30 days at just 1% of the reactor's expected power output, but critically, enough to validate computer models. Over the following 4 years in partnership with PSI, Peterson's team plans to begin transferring uranium-233 bred in the blanket into the core, an essential step towards a self-sustaining reactor that only needs refueling every 3 to 5 years. That's far less often than the traditional reactors, which are refueled every year and a half to 2 years. The team will also optimize systems to clean fission products out of the fuel salt with the reactor still running, keeping the nuclear chain reaction chugging along at a steady clip. For now, their biggest holdup isn't technology, it's regulation. They've got to scale a Matterhorn of paperwork before testing can begin in Switzerland. The PSI is on board, but there's no ski lift through the nuclear approval. And the pass isn't cheap.
I mean, one of the most expensive things are these licenses and approvals. I assume that once we have built more than 100 of these reactors, then the price of all this licensing and approval will also come down.
While Copenhagen Atomics gears up, China appears to have crossed the starting line. In October 2024, a state-sponsored molten salt reactor ran at full power for 10 days with thorium and uranium in its fuel mix. It even bred protactinium-233, a clear sign that nuclear breeding was underway. In April 2025, Chinese researchers announced they topped their reactor up with fresh fuel without first shutting down, another early milestone on the road to continuous operation. But no one has claimed the prize just yet. Neither China nor Copenhagen Atomics have demonstrated a true breeder reactor that produces more fissile fuel than it consumes. Copenhagen Atomics believes hitting that milestone, along with producing reactors at factory scale, could drive energy costs as low as $20 to $40 per megawatt hour, just a quarter of today's average for nuclear energy. To hit that price point, the company is reimagining not just the reactor, but the entire business model. It won't sell its reactors. Instead, it will build, site, operate, and eventually decommission each reactor itself, all without taxpayer funding. And in exchange for taking the heat on nuclear installation, its clients will literally take the heat the reactors produce for use directly in industrial applications or for the conversion into electricity. By taking full responsibility for everything from site evaluation to nuclear waste management, Copenhagen Atomics could make nuclear power viable even in countries that have never had nuclear power plants. Indonesia is one example, and that also happens to be the company's first customer. The plan is to use the energy from the thorium reactions to produce hydrogen and ammonia. Electrification isn't always the answer, and nuclear reactors provide something solar and wind can't: ultra-low emissions heat for everything from producing ammonia and smelting aluminum to drying paper. And thanks to thorium, nuclear energy's ongoing headache of radioactive waste may soon go from a 100,000-year curse to a 300-year chore. Copenhagen Atomics expects to go commercial within a decade, with the biggest breakthrough, which is a self-sustaining breeding reactor fueled only by cheap and abundant thorium. That's a milestone with an uncertain timeline. But it's also a technology our planet can't hardly wait for, because energy unlocks solutions and thorium might just give us the key. But what do you think? Is it still worth the pursuit? And is this technology in the bag, or is it more of a roadmap than a reactor? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. We'll keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support and helping to keep the channel going. Keep your mind open, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.